In recent years, my favorite planet to discuss in these presentations has probably been Jupiter. NASA's Juno mission has provided big and still ongoing surprises to astronomers for several years now, and these revelations have provided a bounty of support for the electric universe theory. Both Jupiter's magnetic field and its tremendous X-ray auroras are considerably more powerful than mainstream astronomical models had predicted. In fact, astronomers' attempts to explain the colossal electromagnetic Jovian environment have provided what I think of as a poignant symbol for the space sciences, and indeed all of institutionalized science today. Observational data presents itself to scientists, and the data doesn't fit with any traditional model. A person standing on the outside of the institution can easily see that this is all the incentive needed to discard old, discredited assumptions and to bravely leap into entirely new, even radical, theoretical possibilities. Unfortunately, this is not how institutionalized science seems to work. Surprising discoveries, including those that appear to outright falsify the edifices of bedrock astronomical theory, only seem to result in the ad hoc tweaking of the previous theoretical framework. In the peer-reviewed literature, astronomers seek the answers in the familiar, no matter how inappropriate the reasoning in the context of a disruptive mystery. A good example of this dynamic can be found in a recent paper attempting to explain an anomalous, roughly periodic phenomena in Jupiter's atmosphere. A team of scientists exploring the Juno data focused on an area of Jupiter dubbed the Great Blue Spot. They were surprised to discover that the jet displayed, quote, wave-like fluctuations that predictably repeated in almost four-year periods. This is a big problem for standard theory. As noted in a recent phys.org report, the research team initially thought the fluctuations might be related to convection-driven flows from within the metallic hydrogen pool that makes up a part of the planet's inner atmosphere. But such a jet, they noted, would almost certainly have periodicity in centuries, not years. As I'll explain in a couple of moments, the periodic nature of the jet undoubtedly causes the ears to perk up of those in our community with electrical engineering backgrounds. However, electrical engineering is not a required area of study for astronomers and astrophysicists. If it were, then many of the longest enduring astronomical mysteries might find quick and easy resolutions. But sadly, the phys.org report reveals just how firmly entrenched the theoretical inertia remains in the space sciences. Describing the two theoretical possibilities the team has proposed to explain the jet's periodicity, it states, "The first is that they are caused by oscillations that develop around the planet's axis. The second is that they are caused by Alphane waves, the type that propagate along magnetic field lines. The researchers are hoping more data from Juno will better characterize the fluctuations they found, perhaps leading to a better understanding of the planet's dynamo." I have to admit, it is a mystery to me how such a statement as, quote, "better understanding of the planet's dynamo" can still appear in any science media, much less scientific literature. The notion that the magnetic field of any planet is powered by an internal dynamo is the farthest thing from settled science, and Jupiter itself provides one of the clearest examples of that. In preparing this presentation, I went back and reviewed the official NASA statements as the Juno data began pouring in. On May 25, 2017, the NASA press release, "A Whole New Jupiter, First Science Results from NASA's Juno Mission," features these telling remarks. Prior to the Juno mission, it was known that Jupiter had the most intense magnetic field in the solar system. Measurements of the massive planet's magnetosphere from Jupiter's magnetometer investigation indicate that Jupiter's magnetic field is even stronger than models expected, and more regular in shape. Mag data indicates the magnetic field greatly exceeded expectations. Juno's deputy principal investigator, Jack Connerney, said of the data, "Already, we see that the magnetic field looks lumpy. It's stronger in some places and weaker in others. This uneven distribution suggests that the field might be generated by the dynamo action closer to the surface, above the layer of metallic hydrogen. Every flyby we execute gets us closer to determining where and how Jupiter's dynamo works." Again, attempting to resolve inexplicable findings through theories whose tenets have predictively failed is a questionable scientific heuristic. I don't mean to oversimplify things or pretend that astronomers have an easy job where answers leap out as self-evident. In the respective electric universe and plasma cosmology communities, internal disagreements do exist, And as a layperson, I can't imagine how complex the electrical circuitry in a dynamic environment such as Jupiter's must be. However, one theoretical claim stands out among our chief principals who have worked and are working with the Thunderbolts project, a claim against which I have never seen evidence or valid argument. That is, incoming Birkeland currents at the poles of the gas giants Jupiter and Saturn are the drivers of the planet's respective magnetic fields, auroras, jet streams, and intense atmospheric and upper atmospheric phenomena. I don't need to remind longtime viewers of Dr. Donald Scott's mathematical modeling of a Birkeland current structure, visualized as counter-rotating cylindrical shells. Nor do I need to remind viewers that counter-rotational wind patterns are indeed observed at each of the poles of both Jupiter and Saturn. Nor do you likely need a refresher on the totally inexplicable, at least to astronomers, fixed polygonal storms that have lived for years or even decades in these planets' upper atmospheres. In the case of the fixed hexagon at Saturn's north pole, fairly recent scientific data has refuted the hypothesis favored by astronomers that the polygonal shape can be explained by simple fluidic dynamics. The hexagon was found to originate at a much higher elevation than can be accounted for by mechanical wind actions. It can only be driven by energies from above, in other words, an external power source. Both of the gas giants are also hotter than conventional models predicted. And I would remind viewers that Emanuel Velikovsky again stunned astronomers when his prediction that Jupiter would be found to emit radio noise was actually confirmed. Again, I don't want to oversimplify things, but in the electric universe, our sun is connected to and powered by its electrical relationship to the incoming Birkeland current that flows along the arms of our parent galaxy. Jupiter's electromagnetic parent is the sun, and as already stated, it is powered, so to speak, by the Birkeland currents that touch down at its poles. I think the most promising evidence-based explanation for the roughly four-year period of the Jovian jet can be found in Wall Thornhill's explanation for the predictable cycles we observe on the sun. He wrote, "The solar magnetic and sunspot cycle is due to the quasi-periodic DC power input to the sun. This variability of power input to the sun can be clearly seen in X-rays and UV light." And these two sentences really underscore the fundamental differences in how astronomers and electric universe proponents perceive and explain celestial phenomena. Just as astronomers have not been able to deny the magnetic universe for over two decades, electric currents in space, from the interactions of planets and other bodies with the sun, all the way to the megaparsec jets of active galactic nuclei, are also occasionally acknowledged in astronomical papers. However, the electricity itself is never viewed as causative, but rather as a byproduct of often extremely weird magnetic and gravitational mechanisms. This is a shorter presentation than usual for me, because out of deference to our many long-term viewers, I'm trying to avoid excessive redundancies from past videos. My thoughts have turned much more philosophical in recent years, and I've concluded that a real theoretical revolution in the space sciences will likely only occur as part of a larger collective shift toward a greater sanity as a species. It seems naive to think that scientists, no matter how composed of intelligence and strong character, would be immune from the basic dysfunctions that have defined our species for millennia. Intellectual and institutional resistance to change is just a more refined, sophisticated expression of the basic threat we all occasionally perceive to our identities throughout our entire lifetimes. This is one of the reasons why I believe so many of us have found resonance here in the Electric Universe community. We see reflected in one another an opportunity to establish together a more healthy, beautiful, and powerful human identity than any of us has ever known. An identity based on sane, compassionate, humble, and loving principles, whose very essence ensures its success and longevity. Incredibly, this moment is unfolding before us even as I speak. I know this as I've never known anything. Through this technology of the internet, we are joining in mind and purpose, out of love and commitment to find a better way, an entirely new way, a way unfolding like the carpet before the feet of the beloved, as they march quietly and with certainty to their destination.
Thank you.